Sea level rise has been affecting communities on the Bayshore now for several years. Driving down the Bayshore, you'll see evidence of overwash of seawater and sand and sediment into the road. The homes are up on stilts now and having septic problems.
Communities that have been dependent upon fishing and farming are struggling to find ways to persist in the face of rising sea levels. Sea level rise is eroding their shorelines, it's flooding their towns, flooding their agricultural fields.
So unfortunately, the communities are really struggling with leaving, staying, that kind of debate as far as living along the coast.
So many of these communities exist right up to the water's edge. For example, the fishing communities are seeing a loss of the shoreline, which means that they can't maintain their marinas there. Communities that have housing or other buildings built up to the Bayshore are seeing, again, the shoreline erode actually moving underneath some of these structures now, making them much more susceptible to storm damage and erosion. Towns are trying to protect the shoreline so that they can protect the roads, the infrastructure, the farm fields against rising seas and rising tides.
So it's a real struggle.
One of the sites that we've been trying to install a living shoreline is a location called Money Island. It's also near a community called Gandy's Beach. And between those two small communities is a large expanse of marsh. Money Island is situated right in the middle of the Delaware Bay oyster beds, which is a primary area for crabbing and fishing for flounder or fluke, for weak fish. But it's called Money Island because the boats are landing their catch and they're making their money there. It's served by a number of commercial docks. So there's a single road that comes out to that across this small spit of marsh. We picked this area because it's key to the fishing community. And if we lose the road going out to that, then this fishery will have to find another port.
Living shorelines are more helpful than traditional bulkhead type structures because they absorb wave energy more than they reflect it. Bulkheads often cause more erosion at the base, and they also have less habitat benefit for the creatures that live in the area where it's being installed. So it's less friendly to the habitat and also sometimes even less effective.
A traditional breakwater is sort of a sterile structure. It doesn't support a lot of life. A natural shoreline does that. And certain components of natural shorelines can be engineered, if you will, to help protect the shoreline so that it isn't susceptible to storms, it's not susceptible to same level erosion, or when those things happen, it will regrow. It's a living sort of structure as opposed to a static, solid piece of structure like a bulkhead or a pile of rocks.
Marshes are natural buffers. That's what they're there for. They move, they change, they erode. But the goal is that they can recover and keep pace with sea level rise.
What's happening recently is we're seeing sea level go up at a much faster pace, and that's drowning the marshes, which means that now that water is moving into the forests, into the farm fields, into the roads, into the cities. And so we're trying to find a way that we can accelerate the rate at which the marshes increase to keep pace with that sea level rise.
So the living shoreline, the oyster castles, which are shell and concrete blocks that are stackable and buildable, and also the shell bags, those bigger structures help slow down wave energy, which allows sediment to fall out and help add some height to the shoreline. And then behind that, there's coconut fiber logs that are installed and planted with spartina grass. All of that stabilizes the sediment even more.
One of the main benefits of doing this is that you maintain the connection between the aquatic environment and the terrestrial environment. There's an interface there where those two things meet, and that interface allows life and living processes to move from aquatic environments into terrestrial environments.
Oysters and ribbed mussels will recruit to these structures. They live at the base of the spartina grass, and they have these byssal threads, the mussels do, which are like stringy rubber bands that help also solidify things. the oysters build structure. They're reef builders. So as they attach to our castles and our shell bags, they're concreting things together. And oysters filter the water. They create habitat for all different fish and critters to hide in.
It's a living structure. We want to enhance the habitat. We want to improve the habitat. We want the habitat that we put out there to be at least as productive as a natural habitat is, if not even more productive, in terms of the number, the kinds and types and abundance of species that grow and live there. You know, one of the areas of growth for food production systems, agricultural systems in New Jersey is aquaculture, and in particular, shellfish aquaculture. And along the Bayshore region, they predominantly do this by building short racks and putting bags on top of them. And those actually act as a breakwater structure. The farms themselves actually can have a positive impact on protecting the shoreline. And there's a nice interaction, a nice synergy there then between building a living shoreline and having a farm out in front of it. And so those two things fit together very nicely. Another thing that happens as the sea level rises is it starts to invade our farmlands, our agricultural fields. It also can increase the penetration into our freshwater aquifers, something we call saltwater intrusion. As you can imagine, what might happen then is once salt gets into these otherwise upland terrestrial freshwater habitats, it's just like if you have a garden, you're not going to put salt water on your garden, it's going to kill those plants. The same thing happens there. If you drive along the Bayshore today, you will see what we call bone forests. And they are stands of trees without any leaves on them. All you see is just the leftover trunks. That's what's going to happen to these agricultural fields. That salt is going to stay in the fields and stay in those soils, and it won't become farmable unless we have some sort of salt-tolerant crop that we can put in there. I first moved to the Bayshore here in 1989 and have seen quite a lot of changes in the Bayshore here. Those communities that have been dependent upon fishing and farming and those sorts of things are struggling to find ways to persist in the face of rising sea levels.
Communities here along the Delaware Bayshore are rich in culture and history. There's a lot of neat stories and folk tales that go back to how the community survived, mostly relying on the bay and its resources for their well-being. So it's important to these people to maintain that.
The salt water is intruding into the forests and the farm fields and the community, and the agricultural land can't move inland further because that's where there's a town or a city or a residential development in there. So we're getting squeezed sort of on both ends. So protecting these shorelines is critical.